Welcome back, everyone, for the Design at Large seminar. And as many of you know, for several decades, the theater and dance department has been at the center of a lot of design teaching, research, and practice here at UC San Diego. And so I'm really excited to have Tara Knight here today to share her work with us. Tara is a filmmaker, animator, and projection designer with a wonderfully diverse background. Usually I don't need speaker notes, but she's done so many different things that I need to keep track of it. I'll share just a couple with you. So she worked on an Emmy award-winning video installation at the San Diego Museum of Art with 4 30-foot walls of video. On a very different medium, she's an animation assistant for Hedwig and the Angry Inch. And recently she's been performing in a series of weekly camera dances at the Museum of Contemporary Art in San Diego. And we tell people that in the seminar they're welcome to bring any format that they like, that we're open to new ways of presenting. And I'm not going to tell you anything about the topic of today because it's just going to blow your mind. It's so much more exciting if Tara tells you about it directly. But in addition to being a really cool topic, she's also going to try for a slightly new presentation format. And she confided in me that she's like, I don't know if it's going to work, but I know it will. So
I don't know if that's how happens. I phrased it.
And please join me in welcoming Tara.
Hi, everyone. Hi. Hi, everybody. So I figured that I'm going to be talking about Hatsune Miku today. And Miku is a phenomenon that is largely web-based. And so I was kind of putting together my presentation. And I was like, should I make a PowerPoint? And I was like, why am I putting all of these? Because it's basically just endless links to things on the web. So I'm just going to do my presentation as a series of tabs. So we will see how this goes. I've actually done this like for undergraduate classes before, and it goes fine. So I'll give it a shot. So I think, does anyone know anything about Hatsune Miku? Not really. I'm just a little bit, but we don't have any experts in here. There's always one person who's like a die-hard fan who shows up to one of these. They'll be here eventually. I know they will be. Hi. So I guess I'll start off by showing Miku just went viral this week. So she's been this underground phenomenon for the last 4 years, which I've been studying, and she was on David Letterman this week. So I'm going to go ahead and show part of that as a kind of introduction. So let's start there. All right, can you see that okay? So I'm going to put it on pause, and I'm going to talk through it. I feel bad for the artists that I'm talking through their music. So Miku is often described as a hologram. She's technically not a hologram. She's projection on a specific kind of glass. And the other time she appears is Pepper's Ghost, which is a 17th century Victorian stagecraft technique, actually. Here, I'm going to skip ahead through the song to the end, to the interaction between Miku and David Letterman, because I think that that's a kind of a really interesting moment. So being this like trippy, everything's kind of crazy reference, right? So Letterman has this kind of, I was there for the technical rehearsals. I've been on tour. I just got off tour with Miku yesterday. So I apologize. I'm a little bit overtired. So if I stop making sense, just be like, cut, stop, move on to the next topic. So he has this kind of practiced puzzlement. I mean, through the technical rehearsals, he knows actually all about Miku, but that's kind of the presentation in the West, particularly about Miku. So this in the last couple of weeks has gone viral. Who is Hatsune Miku? Jezebel. I went to Hatsune Miku concert. It was fucking amazing. BuzzFeed. Actually, BuzzFeed has one of the better articles about Miku because you can tell which journalists actually did interviews about the subject matter before writing about it. here we have the Wall Street Journal, right? That these kind of all these major. So CBS News has changed from, I wanted to show this. This is 2012? Yeah. This is an article from 2012. Yeah, here we are, November 2012. So the fakest pop star. And CBS News over 2 years has come around to saying newest virtual pop star. We've gone from fake to virtual. So what? So these concerts have like captured people's imagination. And what all of this press, or most of this press, misses, and what the Letterman show misses, is actually the most interesting part of Miku. She is constructively collaborated by hundreds of thousands of people online. There is no one Miku. She's not created by any one person. It is a giant, collaborative, cross-natural, national, cross-cultural design project. So this, I'm going to try and explain the very, very, very broad general. Surprisingly, the only press in this last couple of weeks that got it right is the Asahi Shimbun, the Japanese newspaper, right? That they really were able to talk about it. So I'm going to try and give a very, very general overview, and then for about 20 minutes or so, and then we're going to move to Q&A, because everyone has questions about this, especially when they first hear about it, and that's actually much more productive. So I'm going to try, and I'm going to give this specifically for an American context. I do presentations, I've done some, you know, in Japan and things like that. This is specifically an American context. Okay, so let's begin, shall we? let me see if I can get... Hello, where's my cursor? There you are. So, at her most basic, Hatsune Miku is voice synthesizing software. What is voice? Oh, I forgot to introduce myself. Hi, I'm Tara Knight. I'm associate professor of digital media here at UCSD in the theater and dance department, of course, right? Of course, where else would I be located on campus? I've been studying Miku for about 4 years. I've done hundreds of interviews with people all over the world about Miku. I just got off tour. During my day job, I teach undergrads how to use the pitch of their voice to control a video. Like if you're an opera singer, how to control a video using your voice, and other such things, technology, culture, et cetera, art. So, okay. At her most basic, we will return to some of my films that I've been making about Miku. So, this is my YouTube channel, yay. Okay, so at our most basic, Miku is voice synthesizing software. It's software that you can download, and what it does, it's a large bank of phonemes. Phonemes are the smallest unit of human speech, like ha and lo and hello. And so you can string them together, hello everyone today, right? It allows you to string them together melodically using this voice that is Miku. Simple, right? Miku is one of many, so she's what's called a Vocaloid character. Vocaloid is the company developed by Yamaha, originally developed by long, complicated. Miku is a character voice, one of many character voices. So she's owned by Krypton Future Media. And so the larger, I'm going to have to use my arm, okay, larger umbrella of Vocaloid, and then there's Krypton Future Media, which is one company, and that company produces several different Vocaloid characters. Miku is one character. So this is a larger Vocaloid movement that's going on. Today I'm going to talk about Miku specifically because she's what's best known in the West, but I want to point out that Miku is not the only I think in the West is the most popular, but it's not the only character. Okay, so what people do is that you have your software that you've downloaded that you can write a song, and you release that song in the world, right? And at first it began in Japan on a site called Niko Niko Doga, which is kind of like the Japanese YouTube, and people were there. She has now written 100,000 songs. She is now the world's most prolific artist, of course. And none of those are written by any one person, obviously. They're written by thousands of people. So this is where the kind of nature of her voice is often treated like an instrument, right? That she's like a guitar that someone can play and create meaning with in that kind of very traditional instrument fashion. But as you see, as I'll keep talking, it gets a lot more complicated trying to describe what she actually is. So what happens is that say I write a song. I actually have written a song that's part of my documentary. I've never written a song before. I figured if I'm studying it, I should try it. It's kind of nerve-wracking to write a pop song. It's really hard. So you write your songs, and in Japan, if you kind of reach a certain level of popularity, you're called what's called, you're a vocal OP, Vocaloid plus producer. It's a portmanteau, is that what it's called? Yeah, portmanteau of Vocaloid and producer, vocal OP. So some of the more vocal, famous Vocaloid P's, it's a P is a designation that you're assigned from your community, right? You don't just get that, like the community gives you it. And it's usually like a semi-derogatory nickname or like kind of like teasing you about something. So for example, in episode 4 of my documentary series, I interview a guy called Cabra P, and K means hair and bra means bra. And like, it's that his hair was so long that all his friends were like joking that he could like fashion it into a bra. Lo and behold, he becomes Cabra P. Right, so that the names often have this whole subculture element to them, but then hit this mainstream international market. Right, so here example is just a Tumblr of someone's like every week that they do a different, they focus on a different P and kind of program their music. For example, it could be one of thousands. So Vocaloid P's are known for how they tune Miku's voice. Again, in episode 4, which I don't think I have time to show. You guys can watch it online, the magic of the internet. You can watch it later. That it's actually, there was a debate even what verb to use to describe Miku's voice. Are you using Miku's voice? And people said, no, that's not quite right either. At first it was in Japanese, chokyosuru, like to tame, to like, it's like an animal, right? Like to tell an animal what to do. And then they realize, well, maybe that's kind of insulting to Miku, right? That she has this like international following. Like, so the more kind of more slightly accepted verb now is to tune her voice. I think that's mainly what's being used in English, is to tune her voice. So a famous, so say for example, one Vocaloid P tunes her voice to be very, very naturalistic and human sounding. And then another P might make it extremely, electronic sounding. And so that there's a whole spectrum, and you can recognize different P's by how they tune Miku's voice. So she's both one voice and then thousands of voices, right? And this will be a recurring theme, that it's simultaneously one and millions as this large collaborative design project. Okay, so how did they get to the point? Copyright. It's the copyright is treated like a guitar. I write a song with the guitar, I can release it, I own the copyright to it, right? Like Led Zeppelin doesn't get sued by the guitar manufacturer for like rights to the songs they wrote on that Gibson or whatever they used, right? But the decision to keep this character flexible for everyone is where in the design process and in conceiving of her is where it begins to radically change how people relate to Miku. Okay. So I want to show one of my films. I'll go ahead and show it. And it'll be, oh, what is this? And if you look for songs, look, 14 million results for Hatsune Miku song under video, right? Probably not all of those are Hatsune Miku songs, a lot of them, but that's a lot, right? So I want to show, this is Miku Betri, this is the first episode in my series, which tries to look at how everyone, how people think of her as everyone's voice. So I'm just going to go ahead and show it because the film does a better job than I could describe it, which is why I made a film.
If you look up Hatsune Miku on YouTube, you see like thousands and thousands of videos. You know, it's not just like an official group behind Miku. It really is a lot of people making all this content.
She's one artist, but she's the image of thousands of artists.
その見せ方だけじゃなくて、後ろに何千人のクリエイターがいて、それぞれ競い合って作ってる、音楽を作ってる、クリエイトしてる。
One thing Krypton Future Media has done is they have a platform, Piepro, where kind of encourage people to create their fan art songs, post them online, share them, remix them.
Since Hatsune Miku only has like a name and a picture, people are free to use her in any story or any personality. They are free to use her however they want.
それを表現するために今までだとそのキャラクターを使わなければ何かキャラクターで表現したいってことができなかったんですよね。自由に使えるキャラクターでみんなが親しんでいるキャラクターということで、そのいわゆる自分の持っている技術をいろいろな人に見せてあるその媒体としてのミクっていうのがやっぱり良くてですね。
It gives the individual artists the capability to actually create their songs, their style of artwork.
You can make her sing about blood and death, or you can make her sing about the greatest love of your life.
People can make something of themselves. Use her as a voice for some of the things they want to say.
Miku is what you make her.
私の場合は、ボウチュが好きですよということで、勝手に初音ミクボウチュが好きだっていう設定をしてるんですよ。だけれども違う人もいて、初音ミクはすごく、こう、そうですね。例えば悲しい歌を作る人もいるし、楽しい歌を作る人もいるし、いろんな曲が出ていますよね。それはその人ごとに違う設定をしている。はい。だからそれ自分なりに感情を初音ミクに投影してるっていうのだと思います。
But I guess Miku represents something like everyone's creativity.
An icon of a huge group of people working together.
She's just everybody's voice.
I'm not going to watch the credits. Sorry, everyone. I know you'll be very disappointed to not watch the credits of the film. But so, along with there being kind of every genre of music that people write for Miku, right? There's rock, there's jazz, there's country, there's rockabilly, there's techno, there's dubstep, right? Like every subgenre. Similarly, in terms of her image, it's just as open and design what you want, shall we say. Let me grab the next slide. Okay. Oh, no, wrong one. Sorry. Close that. Are people already having questions of how this works yet? Not yet. Everyone's still like, what? What is this thing?
So there's the band.
Uh huh.
Performed with her on Letterman.
Yes.
And I've seen, I think, the same band perform with her before.
Yes, they're just a band for hire, kind of.
Yep. And are they her special band somehow?
It depends on which kind of show it is. Sometimes they pull people who are famous peas into actually be the band, or like you're in the band for the song that you wrote, maybe sometimes, or like you sing alongside Miku. It depends. It depends. Each concert is slightly different. Okay, so moving on. So as with, again, every genre of music, so there's Miku herself, and then there's it, what began as one drawing of Kay. It's like literally the artwork on the software package. One drawing has inspired hundreds of thousands of other drawings. So in addition to everyone's drawing, as you saw in the previous film, there's also derivative characters from Miku. So this is, if you notice up here, this is Hachune Miku, who's the like cuter chibi, like the cute one, right? Or there's something like, if you look up Dayo Miku, let's see if this works, because I was having trouble getting it to load earlier. We'll see. Like Dayo Miku, right, comes from that they made this mascot. It's actually a great example of design, of collaborative design. So they had this like mascot, and it has like this oversized head. And everyone's like, okay, this is falling in the uncanny valley. We hate this. But then it became beloved, because it was so creepy. So now there's all these like figurines, and people draw their own version of it. And it becomes this like really funny, playful version of Miku. Then there's something like Kaneka Miku, which moves into the realm of very dark, like spider robotic version that people have made of Miku, right? And so then there's, I want to show one, just one more because I really love this one. It's so out there. How do you spell it? Shiteyamyo Miku. I think that's how you spell it. Oh, I'm such a terrible speller. I should not be the one doing this. Somebody should have. Oh, here we go. So this is Miku where she's just hair and feet and head, right? And this is its own, this has its own, if you go to Know Your Meme, do you guys all know Your Meme? Yeah, go to Know Your Meme and just like fall down the rabbit hole of this, right? Of all the different ones people have created. This is someone cosplaying as Rolling Rock Miku. Rolling Rock was a song someone wrote about domestic abuse, and then someone else made a video and had this really particular drawing of Miku, and then women now cosplay as that drawing from the music video, right? So, and this was mentioned in the previous film, this Piapro. So Krypton, once they figured out what was happening, they kind of said, okay, well, we'll have our own proprietary site where people can upload things and share them and remix them in addition to just the general internet. So I'm happy to talk about that. That's a really long, complicated copyright question. So we can talk about that if people are interested during Q&A. So how does the actual design process work? Oh, look, I made a film about that. Yay, so let's watch that film. So this film was shown at, actually, maybe I'll skip ahead to some context. So this is the Judy Dolan, who's one of my colleagues in theater and dance, who's a Tony-winning designer, really amazing artist and thinker. And so she, on her blog, she was writing about it. She actually pulled the photos. So this was photos of my this film we're about to watch, showing at the Mori Art Museum in Tokyo, I guess last year. This is the highlight of my career. It was shown. It already has happened. It's over, right? That my film was showing. No. My film was showing like on a wall in the gallery. On the opposite wall was a Chagall, a Rodin sculpture, and like all, I was as part of the same exhibition, right? And I was like, wait, what? You know, like, sorry, just like even spitting, even remembering it. But so the problem of how do you, like, it's a curatorial problem, right? How do you curate Miku when it's this giant collaborative thing? So what they did was they had a whole room that was dedicated to Miku. Instead of having like a little placard, it was like a 10 by 10 foot thing explaining Miku, trying to figure out what do you do with this. So my film, the concert footage, and which played, and then there's a small hologram, and then on the floor, there were 125 iPads that were live streaming, like live polling people adding new Mikus onto the web, and it refreshed once a minute, right? As the best way to try and curate what this is. So this is the film I made kind of for this exhibition called Participatory Culture, and I believe this should be the dual language version, I hope. Let's hope I clicked the right thing.
You have just like viewing and uploading videos, and then the recirculation of videos, whether it's a producer just uploaded a song and then another artist wanted to make a music video for that song, and then maybe fan art evolves from those music videos.
だからそういうホビーの部分で、あの、そう評価をもらえたっていうのが、で、言っても、まあ、一般人なのに、 I am not a musician, but それがやっぱりすごくびっくりして嬉しい。
And people are going to concerts, people are putting on their own concerts, fan conventions. And then, of course, like karaoke is a very important part of how it's been circulated recently. That, I guess, translates back online. So you have things like videos being re-uploaded with lyrics or Utate Mita.
There's a Utate Mita, and they'll sing a cover of it, like they'll just sing the song, and they record themselves, and they'll upload it on, you know, YouTube or Niku Niku Douga.
Niku Niku Douga に上がっている, Odotte Mita っていう ジャンルがあるんですけど, その...
And then there's people who draw PVs, promotional videos for the songs, and there's people who do enso shite mita, which is perform the songs in musical instruments or do rearrangements.
But it's like a very interesting like flux and flow and intermeshing of all practices, and it really just comes down to individuals doing things together, and then it propagates out into this really interesting phenomenon.
まあ、みんな言ってるんですけど、まあ、アイコンですよね。アイコンであったり、そのハブですね。だから、まあ、シンボルですね。アイドルというシンボルもありますけども、いろんな、アート、例えばイラストもそうです、動画もそうです。そういうのも全部つなげる。
If we were to say Hatsune Miku is participatory culture, maybe it's a zeitgeist, maybe it's just the way people think.
I think this world works because you can participate, and it gives you a sense of meaningful participation, that it offers real dramatic uses of this new technology.
So when I was making this series, I realized pretty early on that I was like, okay, I can make like the NPR documentary series about Miku. And then I was like, or I could just be part of the phenomenon and be part of making Miku. And so I really made the choice to say, okay, I want to have my form and content make sense with one another. I'm releasing them online for free under Creative Commons copyright. anyone can remix them. I just got an email from a student in Taiwan who turned the first one, another film, into a ringtone as their school project, right? That they wanted to turn my song into their ringtone. I was like, okay, great, thanks. You know, just send me a copy. And that this is a very different way of approaching what an artist does, what intellectual property is, what your work as a researcher is. Anyhow, I'm just tossing this out here. And that so each film in the series is very, very in my series is very, very different. Episode 5 looks at second versus third wave feminist readings of Miku cosplaying, right? Of like, is this skanky or is this empowering, right? And kind of debates between women about that. Episode 4 really looks at the deep early culture in Japan, et cetera, et cetera. And each one has a different style of animation that's used, a different format. Okay, so this is much more what Henry Jenkins at USC would call like spreadable media, right? That where rather than media or design being controlled by a centralized corporate entity and distributed, this is spreadable, right? It's designed to be spreadable. Miku in and of herself only is spreadable media. And this is where people kind of make the argument that Miku isn't actually a musician, she's not an instrument, she's a platform, or she is a service for other people to create. So what happens when you have this is where I'm kind of trying to wrap up so we can get to Q&A, but like what happens when you have a virtual idol who acts less like Britney Spears or something, or she went on tour with Lady Gaga this summer. I don't know if anyone here went to see Lady Gaga in San Diego. Yeah, nobody else went to the show. Come on, guys, what are you guys doing on the weekend? I said SDSU. But she opened for Lady Gaga here in San Diego and for a big part of the American tour. But this idea that what happens when you have a virtual idol who functions less like Britney Spears or Lady Gaga as a kind of aura of the original, and more like Facebook, right, where it's actually with users sharing and spreading the content, or less like a pop star and more like Wikipedia, where it's hundreds of thousands of people constantly editing her, editing who she is, what she sings, what she wears, how she, like, every aspect of her, right, as this giant collaborative design project. And what this does is that the part to me, this is where I start getting like the little hair standing up. The part that is like, what I've loved talking about people over the years who are involved with Miku is that it changes your relationship to her. That you feel a part of her, you feel connected to her, right? So when Letterman hit, like I got texts from people congratulating us. Like, we did it, right? Who's the we and what did we do, right? So that I'll get to that in a second. But. Think about the inverse of a like. Think about another character, like Disney, for example. If I decided that I was going to take Simba from The Lion King and I was going to write new songs in Simba's voice and release them online, and like then you would do a remix of my version of Simba. Yeah, shut that down, right? Shut it down immediately. So this is a very different way, again, of thinking about copyright, trademark. How it works legally is fascinating. I'm happy to talk about that in Q&A if people really want to get into it. How, why, when, and where it really began in Japan is also you really can't talk about Miku without talking about the kind of Japanese art traditions, without talking about doujin culture, like fan art culture in Japan, and without talking about otaku culture, which is kind of like fan obsessive culture. So that I'm happy to talk more about that. I'm kind of hoping that during Q&A you guys will direct where, because there's so many different aspects. We can talk about the economics of this. How do people make money with Miku, right? So last but not least, now that you have some context, let's go back to the concerts and try and explain this. So Miku's concerts, episode 2, which we probably, it's like 6 minutes, we probably don't have time to watch it today, unless you guys want to later. Episode 2 I made is all about why people cry at the concerts, right? Because people, I have to admit, I had been on tour, I had seen the shows from backstage or like technical rehearsals, I hadn't really, and then the last night I was like, okay, damn it, I'm gonna be in the pit, I'm gonna be down there with all the people with their glow sticks, and I'm gonna experience it for at least 10 minutes. I'm gonna see the opening number. And I just started bawling, right? Because it was this collective sense of being there with people, which was radically different than, say, going to see my favorite artist. So anyway, I can talk about that, or we can show the film, either one. Anyway, so the concerts, going back to these. So in a way, the concerts are kind of the least radical aspect of Miku, because it's a pop idol on stage performing in very like a proscenium theater, and there's an audience. But at the same time, it's also an interesting example of kind of the top-down and bottom-up business models of Miku. So it's a bottom-up production model of you can write a Miku song, and you can write a Miku song, and you can write a Miku song, and we can share it, and then I'll make an edit of yours, and then someone else will make a video for it, and share, 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 in this bottom-up production model. And then for the concerts, the company comes in and acts in a top-down curatorial fashion and pulls out which songs to include, right, and which to kind of carry in this like big international, holy shit, it's on Letterman level of kind of conversation. So, and I have to say that it's only in the last month that finally people in the West are hearing it, like are kind of understanding the full impact of Miku. Even the Wired articles are just like, honestly, okay, is this gonna go on the internet? Shit, okay, maybe I'll say it off the record later when I don't have my mic on, about the kind of vaguely racist articles from Wired and other places, right? So anyhow, so the concerts here, this really interesting mix of bottom-up production and top-down curation, which is what company functions like that, or what else? I can't even think of another example of something where it's bottom-up and top-down. Maybe you guys can help me figure that out, all you crazy design people who know lots about this.
Instagram,
mm-hmm. In that
it wouldn't be interesting unless people created the content.
Yes.
And it's end user creativity.
Mm-hmm.
But there is a platform that structures what kind of end user creativity.
Yes, it definitely structures it, yes. So there's the kind of creating the content and then a structuring of the content, yes.
And photographing my sandwich at lunch isn't as creative as writing a song, but I think there are some similarities.
Oh, definitely. In fact, I would actually say that it's even more mundane than photographing your sandwich at lunch, which I'll get to in a second. So bottom-up, top-down concerts, exemplar of that, yeah. Okay, moving on. So I would, kind of looking at Miku now, I would say it's kind of like punk or something like that, that punk started for really, really specific social, cultural, economic reasons in a very, very, very sub, really, really specific part of the world, and then kind of has gone massive. I would say that Miku and Vocaloid culture may do a similar thing, of start in the sub thing, but have some elements that people are interested in that will continue it growing. I think the concerts, like a year from now, nobody's gonna give a shit about holograms and concerts anymore. We can talk about Tupac and like how the Tupac hologram is similar to related to this or not really. And then we can talk about that later if you guys want. But this idea that kind of similarly, is it going to hit really big? And I think the only way it'll hit really big is if people make things. It can't just purely be consumption. It has to be this collaborative design model. And that's, to me, the really exciting revolutionary part of it. Because going back to this idea of I felt a part in the crowd, when I interview people, they say, well, I can't write a song. Oh, I wanted to give an example. Shoot, I don't have time right now. But when you look at the vast, there's so many points of entry into the community. So maybe you can't write a song, but you can write software. So one guy wrote an entire software program that allows you to, it's like a basic 3D animation software, and released it online, open source, for free for everyone. And now there's like a whole genre of contests, international contests. It's called Miku Miku Dance. You guys can download it, make Miku Dance. Go crazy. People put their modifications up, they put their own models, they share them. There's a whole element that's that. Someone did something called Songer. It sometimes takes a while to load. I might find it during Q&A if people are interested. Oh, here it is, perfect. So this is a mapping that someone made, just because, you know, they wanted to. this is Melt. This is one of the very, very early Miku songs. And this is how it's connected to all other songs in the Vocaloid universe. And so you can kind of go around and see how these are all interconnected. And this one did a remix of this one, did a remix of this one. Just because this is their contribution to the community. Something like Voca Room. This is something, again, I feature in episode 2 in Japan, which is about people in Japan getting together and just talking about Miku, like at a bar, right? And talking about like a fandom the way they would. But then the P's also come to that, that there's a real potential for the P is actually was the one serving everybody beer. Like he's the bartender for a couple hours, right? That it's not, here I am, I'm the idol, I'm the like Mick Jagger, you know, kiss the ring, buy a t-shirt, right? Or something like, it's just endless. Miku Monday, which this is a weekly American event that you can go and head to the sync room. And this is an ongoing, I'm going to put it on pause just for a second because it gets really loud. It gets really loud, really loud, really fast. So you log in and you can like, it just so happens there are like, you know, six people online right now. And this is the playlist that they've created. Hang on, let me pull down a little bit more. Of 217 songs that are just kind of running. And you can join in and add, you know, make requests. And it's like an ongoing, and then the countdown clock is for, you know, the day when everybody really comes on and there's like 50 people that they all kind of get together once a week online. Right, because they're the one person in Omaha who's into Miku, right? No, I met all of them in New York on like a concert. I met people from basically every state. We should have had like a map that was like people who came from Georgia, people who came from Mexico. One guy came from Spain. He'd never been out of Spain, didn't speak any English, and came to LA to see the concert, right? Like it has this really dedicated fan base. That's why the Letterman thing went viral. I mean, Letterman guests get like, you know, a couple thousand views, it's like hitting 2 million. Okay, so some people have talked about kind of Miku on, okay, so, oh yeah, Miku Miku Dance, Songroom. The example of a leak, I might give that during the talkback if people, okay, yeah. So here's the most radical part to me about Miku, right? The Instagram, the like mundane, like I'm taking a photo of my salad and I'm putting it online. And like maybe like my mom likes my salad or something, right? But nobody else really gives a shit about my salad. That. Right? That's what happens, right? Like, it's so mundane, but it's kind of beautiful, but mundane. That the most radical part is that people feel a connection to Miku the way they don't feel, say, necessarily with Lady Gaga, or it's a different kind of relationship. Because the folks on Miku Monday, when I met them in New York, they were like, we did it, right? We were part of this, that commenting, sharing, spreading, translating, is considered part of making Miku, because she doesn't have any other existence, right? So you can be someone who writes a song, you can be someone who writes some software, you can be someone who like designs the new logo that gets picked up and on all the t-shirts, or you can just participate by sharing, doing what you can, and that, and people have this really meaningful sense of participation through Miku. Okay, Q&A, shall we commence? Yes.
Yeah, like, so when you were talking about the verbs that we choose to use when talking about Miku, like, all of my feminist Reddit alert alarms went off. Even, like, no matter what gender was describing Miku, they were all saying things like, she's you know, a tool, we use her. She's,
yes.
She's like this vessel.
Right? Yes.
She's like this feminine object that, and yes. I mean, like, So I know there's other Vocaloids, based mm-hmm. on what you were saying, mm-hmm. and I mean, have you looked at the differences between male Vocaloids and female Vocaloids? And
yes.
Is there anything different between the way people describe them?
I feel like I could speak more comfortably about the American audience in that. The Japanese kind of gender with Miku is, I wouldn't feel publicly okay talking about that in terms of like, I just don't know enough, right? Oh. But the American fan base, I feel like I could really talk about. So the last couple, again, on tour, I saw a lot of crossplay. Crossplay is when you cross your gender in performance, right? A lot of people, a lot of men crossplay as Miku, like hundreds, right? And then also the opposite way, that for the male characters, there are a lot of women dressed as the male characters. Actually, the majority of them, the male characters, were women dressed as the male characters. That the kind of very, there's a very fast, easy read on Miku that, oh, she's young, she's a pop star, it's gross, this is this like some sort of weird hentai, like jerk off material, right? She's anything you can make her be. Sorry, I'm a Frank person. I grew up in a, sorry. Yay, I just said jerk off now, I've said it twice. there's a very quick, easy read, which is like, this is disgusting, you know, objectification of women, right? But then when you actually start talking to the fans about what they get out of it, it's actually hearing that, this is kind of the second versus third wave or second versus post-feminist critique a little bit, they find it really empowering. Right? They feel like they can express themselves in a way. They can maybe express their sexuality in a way. They can maybe express their leadership abilities in a way. They can express something that otherwise they cannot, right? Or that they are made visible or rendered visible in a way that otherwise they are not. And that's very different from the kind of second wave feminist, young lady, go home, put some clothes on, right? Wow, okay, that's a terrible summary of second wave feminism, but like, you guys know what I mean, right? I'm using some shortcuts here because there's so many moving parts. But so that's actually what episode 5 is all about. So I would check it out and send me an email. Tell me what you think. Because that's a real thing, right? Like, what? How am I as a woman, do I really feel comfortable as, you know, a feminist woman endorsing this? And through the conversations I have with women, both here and in Japan, I would say, yes, I feel comfortable, right? Because it's, rather than it being like my view on like looking at what you're doing and determining, oh, okay, well, this is what you're doing is fucked up. It's actually hearing their experience of what they're doing. It's actually very empowering. Yeah, does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Sort of, yeah.
It's
it just keeps like, and then there's like the feminist part, there's the economics part, there's the copyright part, there's the, yeah, yeah. Oh. Yeah.
Could you give an estimate of the size of the portion of Japanese people, of all the people actively participating?
Yeah, so Miku just hit 2 million Facebook fans. And over half of them are American.
American.
In part because that speaks a lot about who uses Facebook in general, that like Facebook isn't nearly as popular in Japan. But there's at least 1 million people in America who are fans of Miku. Does that make sense? So,
do you think there's more in Japan or less?
More than 1 million? Well, Japan, I would say like the rule of thumb I would say right now is anyone under 25 in Japan knows who Miku is. Right, that she's on like batteries and car commercials, and there's a certain like cultural presence that she has. It's kind of like, it's not Hello Kitty level, right? But it's certainly, people know who she is. And people in Japan think this shit is weird too, right? That it's not that it's somehow, again, that this is a way in which a lot of the kind of problematic stereotypes about Japanese culture, about, you know, kind of technocratic culture, et cetera, get woven into the narrative of Miku, which it may not actually have anything to do with it, that, that people in Japan find, like, why are you going to a hologram concert? What's up with that? That it's not this kind of naturalized, oh, of course, all those Japanese people do weird things, the way a lot of Western media portrays it. Yeah. Did that answer your question?
Yes.
Yeah, I wanted to ask about, you know, you made a lot of emphasis about how this is unique and radical.
Mm-hmm.
Example of if you tried to publish a CD of Simba, that would be shut down. But there are huge, you know, remixing, fanfic writing,
yes.
I'm just curious, like, mm-hmm. where do you see differences, similarities?
Yes, I think that Miku is the first thing that something from the ground up was designed this way. Right, she was designed to be endlessly remixed. The company didn't know this is what was gonna happen. That's the other thing. They thought that people would just like make some songs. Right? They had no idea that this giant international phenomenon would take off. That in a way, unlike like slash novels, something like that, like, do you guys know anything about slash novels, like in Star Trek fan fiction? Okay, so like slash novels are like K slash S, like Kirk slash Spock is like the, you know, writing that they're lovers on the planet, and this is a kind of way to write in queer text and queer, and kind of highlight kind of aspects that may be missing or that may be latent in the predominant text. So like they're like that tradition of what's called doujin, D-O-U-J-I-N, doujin shi is like the things that are made. Doujin tradition in Japan is off the charts, right? Like imagine fan fiction here and fan art here, and then times like multiply by a couple decimal points in terms of its importance, in terms of its acceptance, in terms of, so I think that part of it, again, is that it's no mistake that it was Japan, right? There already is this rich cultural tradition of this happening. I think that she's kind of the first, unlike Simba, where I can take Simba and like use Simba and like do some crazy remix of Simba. Simba always refers back to the original Simba. Right? It's always like a referent back to the original. With Miku, she is already that remix culture, right? Some people have described her as remix culture. Like that's the best way to describe her. Not as an idol, not as an instrument. What's interesting, there is now a rising canon Miku.
An emerging canon,
yes. And that's often what's played at the concerts is the canon, yeah. At the official concerts. Fans throw their own concerts, but these are like the official ones that have all the money. Yeah.
It's so interesting, you know, because there are people who do this kind of thing when it really is set up to be so controlled by a corporate entity, and these kinds of, you know, stories spin off and become their own sub canons.
Mm-hmm.
People cosplay as these like very popular.
Exactly.
Totally like, you know, some other character in Frozen that's not.
Yes. Exactly.
I wonder where it's going to go.
Yeah. Well, let me try this. Let me give this as an example, Miku and her leek. So Miku is associated with a vegetable, like a green onion or a leek, right? Of course, logically. The way this came about was that several years ago, in like 2008, someone took a traditional Finnish song and made a vocal and used Miku's voice to sing this traditional Finnish song. And in it, Miku has this like leek that she's spinning, because it's like a nonsense song. It's like a really cute song. So this Finnish song goes via Japan, then a whole bunch of people in like Indonesia and other places are performing it, right? This is like weird kind of cross-culture exchange. But from that, people said, okay, wait, Miku, the leek is so cute, we want Run with the Leek, right? And so that's why the glow sticks at the concerts are green, because it's a green leek, right? Or like, hang on, handmade leek glow stick. I have this like in my, let's see if we can find. Oh yeah, here we go. So a whole bunch of, some of the fans I met in New York, a lot of them I met before, but one guy who I hadn't actually met before, he came up to me and he handed me a homemade leek that he had like fashioned together out of several other ones. And he was just handing them out to people so that they could have them too, right? So it goes from this Japanese artist taking a Finnish tune via Indonesia back to the leek, gets picked up to a glow stick that's a corporate, like, okay, this is now official thing, and then someone hacks it and does their own like version of it. This is from the beginning, this is how Miku is designed to be. Yeah. Yeah.
So I mean there's kind of this economic disparity. Yamaha is making money from these concerts.
Mm-hmm.
$1,000 to do that.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. So I'm wondering if there's any like backlash from those mm-hmm. kinds of people, like, or mm-hmm. are people just so happy to be a part of it that they don't care that there's this disparity? Right.
Right. Well, that's the same kind of like Marxist materialist like Facebook critique, right? Like, why am I providing all this content while you guys become billionaires, right? I'm in San Francisco right now, like, for the next 6 months I'm on sabbatical, and I'm like, what the fuck is going on here, people, right? Like, so that, yes, right? This is a real concern, and it's a concern that a lot of people have. So there's kind of, Yamaha isn't actually making a ton of money off of it. Yamaha produces Vocaloid. Actually, no one's making a ton of money off of it, which is the interesting thing. Because so much of it is remix culture. And Krypton, who owns Miku and owns the copyright and trademark to Miku, they license her to companies, right, to use officially like Toyota or Lady Gaga, right? They license Miku to Lady Gaga. But they don't make any stuff themselves. They don't make a product in that traditional sense. They only provide a service in that same way Facebook does, right? So the service model is the same way that it's kind of like, and unlike Facebook, which has all the spec money around it, I mean, maybe one of you guys is the expert on how Facebook makes money, craziness, right? But it's not, and so the kind of profiting off of one's individual labor. So I'm going back to the leek example. So the person who first uploaded the leek video didn't make any money from that. Like, nobody paid them to say, like, okay, now leek is now officially part of the canon of Miku, right? Like, she is, like, really, I mean, it's thousands and thousands of that, right? Like, Miku has a leek, right? So, of course, right? but that, I would say, I have not interviewed that fan. In fact, I've debated interviewing that fan as an example of, I suspect that the idea that hundreds of thousands of people, like, make stuff from your small contribution is the point, right? That is the thing that has certainly been true in Japan. As it spreads internationally, especially in America, where there's like the desire to monetize everything, right? Like that, we'll see what happens there, right? Yes, I'm sure they will, right? So that's the argument for why it's not an economic exchange, right? It's all the other kind of cultural cachet or feeling like you're contributing to something larger, et cetera.
But yeah. Actually, what is the difference between licensing it to Toyota mm-hmm. or to a private songwriter?
So this is a difference between, oh, this is a good point. This is going to the copyright trademark part of it. So her voice is treated entirely like an instrument. Anyone can write any song and fully profit from that song. So if I write a song using Miku's voice and a million people buy my CD, because people buy CDs, then I receive all the money from that. Her likeness, her image, however, for licensing purposes, is not that open, free, you can do whatever you want. So something like, I just had a really good example in my head. Okay, so they will license Miku to something like, here, I'll do Miku Toyota.
Is she on the iTunes?
Oh yeah, there's like hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of songs on iTunes that people have made, yeah. So they did this like big ad campaign with Toyota, and it totally backfired. People really hate it. They're like, why are you licensing it to this giant thing? That was part of it. Also, the style, there's an ad that I don't even know if they've pulled it. Like, this really, like, not great animation. Like, there are all kinds of problems with it. But another example that they do is they tend to collaborate with companies. Miku-san, I might have to switch into. Yeah, here we go. This was a mom and pop, like, cracker shop, Osembe cracker shop in Tokyo, or not in Tokyo, I can't remember where they're based, but they said, okay, well, we figured out this new printing technology. We can print, color print on the cracker. We want to highlight this. Can we use Miku? And they were like, well, what's in it for the fans? And that's usually the question, is what's in it for the creators? So what they did was they had a contest, and they said, okay, well, they printed 10 different crackers. You upload your image, and they pick 10. And then they chose those 10 and put them on the cracker. And then if I believe this is correct, I would have to fact check this, that on the inverse side is a QR code, and you take the QR code and you take your phone, and that goes to the song that's inspired by the image on the other side, right? The Domino's Pizza one, they had this. So even in the licensing, there's kind of a real attempt to keep this collaborative Domino's Pizza and Miku. Yeah, this is this crazy ad for it that was like very, yeah. It was kind of, hang on, let me show an example. So, here we go. So you like, I don't know if this describes it all that well. So you take your phone, oh yeah, this is it, okay. So you take your phone, where's my phone? So you get your pizza box in the mail, or not in the mail, but you know, delivered to you. You got that would be funny. Okay, so here's the pizza box. You have your pizza box, and you hold up your phone, and you like have the app, and you hold it over this, and you can see, just so it's like you can see the picture of the thing, and then you see Miku, and she sings you a song. All of those songs that were used were written by Domino's employees, right? So again, that it's not just that there's always, there usually, I don't want to say it, but there's usually this attempt to include part of this participation, even in the licensing deals. Yeah. Yeah. Did that answer your question, sort of? Oh, do you want to ask it again, or did I answer it?
Yeah, but about another question.
Yes, yes.
People try to project their other medium, like make their dance in a special way, mm-hmm. or even talk.
Mm-hmm.
Can't you talk?
Oh, yeah. I mean, think of it this way.
You make conversation?
Well, again, it's like anything else, like interactive media. You can make anything interact with anything else, right, in a way. But I would say that think about a violin. You can make a violin talk, right? Like, but it will have that melodic quality. So she does talk, and she can say, you know, hello, everyone. You can write her to say, like, hi, everyone. I listened to Tara's presentation about me. You can write that. I could have written that for this. That's fine. But this idea that she has, like, I remember when I was in, this is a couple years ago when I was at one of the concerts in Tokyo, a French reporter was asking me about it, and I was trying to explain, he really wanted to interview Miku. And I was like, there's no Miku to interview in that really traditional way. And he was like, okay, well, maybe someone could write an interview and then like have her say it. And I was like, but that's not really how it works, right? That sense of a single set self is not how this world works, right? That it really is designed to be this a voice that you can use, a voice that you can feature. Feature is usually in English, like that's how it would be like Tara Knight featuring Miku, Hatsune Miku. So feature, they totally pull that from like hip hop culture, right? It's like totally feature, it's not a lot of featuring. And that's in Japan too. So it'll be K-Bura-P featuring Hatsune Miku, yeah.
But what keeps people from doing that? What keeps people from like setting up an interview and just typing what she should say?
Potentially nothing. That's where the crowd would probably come in and be like, what are you doing?
Yeah, okay.
Right?
So that's the only,
I don't know. Actually, technically, I think if it were like on TV, there's probably some sort of licensing problem of like, you're not, you're misleading who, you know, I don't know. It's also, it involves international trademark law, which is not really my specialty. But that said, I think if that went on the internet, the fans would be like, well, what's up with this? Like, you're missing the point. Yeah. That would be my guess. Yeah. Yeah.
So when you go to a concert, are the songs that she's singing, are they being generated by the people in the audience?
Live. No, they are not live.
So
no.
These are like top-down songs that have been selected?
Yes. Yes. If we go back to Miku Monday, like, I'm guessing that at any given time, like, one of these was a song. That was, it was video playback. It was video playback.
Okay.
Yeah. So the technology does exist to make her be interactive, right? That's not really all that hard at this point. I think it's more that why would we want it to be interactive? Does that make sense? Because again, this was a similar problem. Like, a lot of the fans were like, and a lot of people were critical of the Letterman performance because there wasn't like a context-giving interview. Right? Like a sit-down interview, right. Like being like, oh, and by the way, let's try and explain Miku, right? Like, this isn't just a concert. It's all these other things that took me the last hour to explain. So part of it is that most musical guests don't get an interview. That's one part. But part of it is that who would be that person to do the interview? Because if it was like the CEO of Krypton, who's the company that owns Miku, right? Well, that people would say like, oh, so this one Japanese guy makes this like weird cartoon thing, and that's not what it is. If it were, say, the head of global marketing, who's a Japanese woman who speaks English fluently, oh, and it would have to have a translator. If it was a Japanese American woman who speaks English fluently, Japanese woman who speaks English fluently, who's the head of global marketing, like, people already mistake her for Miku. They think that she is Miku, that Miku's like her puppet or something. Right? Or that she's like the woman behind it. Or if you have me as like an academic who studies this, who knows the world really well, why is this crazy white lady talking about this Japanese hologram, right? That who is the person who would talk, who would, to, again, the format is to narrow it down to one person. And similarly, the kind of, to narrow it down to one interview or to narrow it down to one kind of interactivity with, you know, you and I are having a talk. I'm, you know, I program Miku to like respond back to your questions and she can have talk back. Like, that is kind of missing the point in a way. It's narrowing it.
So then when the top-down people come and choose songs that will be good at the concert, they go through all these thousands of websites that people have posted up, like this one would be pretty fun to
have. Yeah, I would say that, yes, so I think that the songs that are chosen for the concerts tend to be, not all, tend to be things that are submitted via PrepPro. This is their, so we have like I don't know, do you want me to translate this? It doesn't matter, it's the idea. So this is a Miku song called Calling You, and that here we can listen to it right now. So, and you can have your illustrations that you upload of Miku, et cetera, et cetera. So it tends to be things that they pull from their proprietary site. PrepPro is also a portmanteau, but I can't remember what professional something, like collaboration, but that doesn't make any sense. Something that means something like that. I can't think of it right now. Did that answer your question? Like, so it tends to be things, and they also, in addition to having this, they also have an actual music label, which is a very, very small part of their business. And that's where they just kind of say, like, when somebody goes super viral, they say, hey, do you want to come be on our label and we'll help promote you and you'll get, you know, like, and you'll get a licensing fee. It's a much more traditional music model. Yeah.
In the community, did the idea pop up to decide about Miku's fate in a somehow structured democratic process, or would that go entirely against the idea?
That is a very good question. Is there a Miku court? Is there a Miku vote? Yeah. It's interesting. Like, that part is totally fascinating to watch. Because something like one of the few times Krypton tried to say something was out of bounds, they kind of said, like, no X-rated stuff. Right? And the community was like, too bad. Like, you said you made this for us to use however we want. If I want to make X-rated stuff, if I want to make Miku porn and make Miku sing about, you know, sex or whatever, like, I get to do that. So the company responded by saying, okay, well, that's fine. You guys can make whatever you want. You're right. But you're not going to be featured on PrepPro, the kind of official site, right? So there was an example of actually the company trying to control and police Miku and the fans coming back and being like, no, you don't get to. But it wasn't like a democratically elected group of representatives who then went to Krypton and made their case. It was, you know, 100,000 tweets, 100,000 like YouTube crashing something, internet trolls on the case qualities. Yeah. So yeah, it'll be interesting to see again, especially my films. I'm so grateful. I'm so happy and grateful that like my films have been bootlegged into like Russian and Vietnamese and all these different languages because I allow them to circulate this way. So
it's not really even bootlegged if it's allowed.
Exactly, it's not bootlegged because I just said I saw people were doing it. I was like, okay, go for it. In fact, I'll include it on my channel. So once this really does hit a kind of certain international, then there's all kinds of cross-cultural issues that pop up. There's all kinds of, is it a democratic system that we want for this? Like, how does that actually work? That the kind of, we're at this really interesting point where it's hitting international status enough that a lot of these questions are going to pop up. Because it's a lot of it's language-based, right? That most of it up until now has been in Japanese and in this very, very sub-cultural way. Yeah.
The thing that sort of interests me is the principles behind something like this and where it might go next. I mean, the thing that sort of blows my mind in the same way that Wikipedia blew my mind is that you know, if someone had said that I'm going to design a language, you know, design an encyclopedia and
people are going to edit it,
and you just go, yeah, sure, you know,
exactly.
There were some principles in that design of empowering all kinds of different people with different expertise, feeling part of this larger community that seems very much like this, but maybe benefiting from the history, seeing that happen.
Exactly. Like, it is not a mistake that Miku comes after Wikipedia, right? It is not a mistake that Miku really hits right when YouTube and video sharing becomes fast and easy enough and you can do on your computer at home, right? Like, there's a lot of really particular reasons why but Nico Nico, like, really was like, okay, we can actually have decent quality videos and be able to share them, right? That it's all these reasons why it's emerging right now and kind of bubbling up and pushing on copyright questions, on economic, who gets paid in all of this? Does anybody make any money from it? How do you control that? Like, what does a company do when they provide a service, not a product, right? Like, all of these questions are embedded within what happens with cross-cultural design, right? What happens when my Miku, so I make my Miku and it goes viral, and then somebody, I saw, it was so funny, like watching all these guys like bootlegging outside Hammerstein Ballroom. I don't know if you guys know Hammerstein Ballroom, but it's like this like place where like a lot of like punk acts were in the 80s, and like it has this like deep rock history. So Miku's at the Hammerstein Ballroom, and outside like there are all these guys bootlegging posters, right? It was kind of like, wow, like that, we've reached some sort of thing where people are bootlegging the poster of the thing that's actually technically sort of open source, but not quite. It's still trademarked, you know, that it's really interesting remix culture moment. Yeah. So that's why for me, I mean, it's absolutely fascinating. And the deeper you dig, the more complicated it becomes. So that's why I'm happy that it's gone viral on Letterman. I'm a little bit saddened that it really does take an hour to explain these things, right? It's not like there's some, maybe somebody can figure that out. Please let me know. Because even just, the question I ask almost everyone I interview is try and describe Miku to my mom, right? And it's funny because my mom is actually super tech savvy and like loves Miku and is like a fan on Facebook, and she'll send me stuff because I don't read I'm never on Facebook. She's like, Tara, why aren't you on your Facebook page? Miku's doing all this cool stuff. Mom. So any other questions people have? It's a little bit much to take, I know. Yeah. Does it apply to stuff you guys are doing and thinking about and learning? That's another question I have, that as an artist, it certainly does, right? As someone whose profession is design and designing things and thinking about building systems for other people to use. It's like, wait, what? This is this whole other potential model.
This whole thing of designing things at scale that most of us just can't get our heads around.
No. No, like even as an artist, I mean, I make like weird avant-garde films that like me and my 10 friends see, right? And so to have like, I upload a video and it's like the view count goes up immediately. Like I can watch it just tick up just because of the scale of it, of Miku's popularity. There's that, and then there's something else I was gonna say about scale. Wow, that's enough. Yeah. Any other questions? Is this relevant to you guys at all? Like, is it help in terms of thinking? I don't know what all your backgrounds are.
Uh-huh. And there's a real, you know, it's a real huge dialogue about authority and where does it come from and like who gets to subvert it or not. And is it, you know, some people decide that certain kind of subversions of authority are okay.
Or okay, some or not, yes.
Although, you know, like,
yes.
Is it really open source, you know, like if it's a sort of a trademark kind of open source, you know, I think that all of those questions are happening in entertainment and they're also, at least, you know, for me.
In teaching. I would love to teach like a giant online course about Miku and like just embrace the spirit of Miku in a giant course. So if someone can help me do that, because I'm like, I don't know what that looks like. But
in, you know, really small, like I think about dance. I mm-hmm. love to dance and I'm part of like social, not professional in any way.
Mm-hmm.
Social dance communities that are very like bottom up.
Mm-hmm.
People organize these kinds of things. And I know, you know, certainly for like all kinds of urban dance stuff, YouTube has been
mm-hmm.
sharing it all over the world, and,
mm-hmm.
And now, you know, a lot of these people get like featured on TV shows,
yes.
And like that, where previously, you know, they really came from.
Yes, where it's like,
crowd,
yeah. Exactly. This is Undote Mita, which is people dancing Miku's dances and then uploading them online and sharing them with one another. Yeah, that's the whole subgenre
yeah.
of learning the dance and uploading
I have
it.
One other tiny point of connection, which is data and do like analytics to figure out what's going to be popular, what's going to be profitable, and this is like all of this work happening, you know, for you. This huge base is curating already what's popular, which is not a new concept. You know, we've been talking
right.
about memes for a long time.
But right.
Like, you know, it's still a problem we haven't solved.
And it's on the scale. Right. Maybe it's not a problem we haven't solved. It's a question we haven't like asked in
it's
the right
really
way. Simple, right ways.
You know, material out there, and instead of saying Harvard is the best, you know, we let everybody into the same ballgame and let the best.
Yes,
like,
well, that is, yeah,
that
is, it's the questioning of expertise, the same way Wikipedia questioned it. This is when, like, I start showing this to a lot of artists. Everyone's like, well, that's nice, but they make that kind of, like, non-professional stuff, right? Like, this is a bunch of people in their, like, bathrobe making artwork, right? And to me, I'm like, oh, right. This is hitting on the, I'm the expert artist. I'm the expert designer. Why are you getting to do this? That's my job. The same way the like encyclopedia folks had that pushback, right? So I think that there's actually a very interesting possibility in terms of, yeah, yeah. It might, I would love it if it redefined the role of the artist, right? Rather than being this like romantic vision of, oh, my unique self, I'm so great and so awesome. And, full romanticism, I'm an artist and I'm beyond what everyone else thinks, right? Like it's when you say it like that, it's such a like old-fashioned sounding thing, but we really do believe it still, right? That I'm the special unique thing on like no one else in the world. But that has then, like, I don't know if any of you guys read Charles Taylor and kind of talking about authenticity and kind of the culture of authenticity. And I don't know if anyone reads that philosopher, he's based out of McGill. Yeah, you had another question.
Yeah, I had a question along those lines. Like, I was wondering how much of the content is really truly original and
mm-hmm. Yes. So maybe another way of saying that is while there are different ways into the fandom, right, that I can just click or share or like or comment, that if someone else were to write a song, they're kind of like, whoa, you wrote a song. Like, that's awesome. Right? That there is still that kind of sort of hierarchical sense. But is anyone on Imgur, any of those kind of things, right? Like original Imgur, okay. This is my, beware, ready for the time suck. You will never have your life back. So this is where memes begin. So this is just a, like, it just compiles the most viral images of the day. And you can scroll through them. But like in the imager community, someone who posts OC original content is kind of viewed, like if you just repost it and don't say you're reposting it, it's like, come on, like you're stealing something. I think there's something similar to that, that in Japan, there's a real, like this is the part I also hope spreads. There's a real importance to attribution. So if I do a remix of your thing, I make it perfectly clear. This was the original work. Here's a link to the original work. Here's their name. Here's the blah, blah, blah. That it's really, there's about attribution. Or that if you do, like, pretty much any American pop song has a Vocaloid cover that someone has written that, you know, I don't know, I don't follow American pop music well enough, but what's a really big pop song that everyone knows? Whitney Houston, I Will Always Love You. I'm sure there's at least 15 different Vocaloid Whitney Houston cover, like covers of Whitney Houston songs. So, and there it will be very clearly marked, this is a cover. Or this is what's called a PV, a promotional video. Yeah. Did that answer? Yeah. So that it's usually it's marked as such. And so there was actually a big problem a couple years ago now, between people taking things off of Nico Nico, the Japanese site, and uploading them onto YouTube, but not giving the attribution. They're like, well, I just want to share it. And like everyone was saying, no, you don't get to, the attribution has to be part of it, even if you're well-intentioned and just want to share it. And then there was so much, I don't know, this is an ongoing debate as to why it started happening, but YouTube started pulling a lot of Miku videos and a lot of Vocaloid videos because they assumed it wasn't original content even when it was. Like that was a big problem of like YouTube being like, one person would just write in and be like, they didn't write that song, and YouTube would yank it. And then it's like, wait, I did write that song. I'm the person who wrote that song, even though you don't think that I could write a song like that because I'm a nobody. Yeah. That was part of the reason for that whole controversy. Somebody else could, there's some other people in the world who could describe that controversy better than I can, yeah.
Subcultures start to expand. Mm-hmm. It's sort of an opportunity to look at how culture itself sort of works.
Yeah.
So in this case, like if it's just a subculture of Japanese fans, mm-hmm. it's not quite as generalizable. But now that it's going international, you sort of have an opportunity to see how culture adopts these symbols and how these symbols transform across this sort of massive scale. So I mean, like, I think this is actually a wonderful opportunity to gain a lot more general principles about how humans work together and collaborate, mm-hmm. and even like fundamental things about how cultures work that you can definitely extract.
Well, think about the early days of Wikipedia, right? There's a certain turning point where it's like, okay, no, people do use Wikipedia every day, right? And that what happened there and what was the shift and what were the cultural shifts going on there, and you can really, really dig deep. So I started a listserv of all the people who are studying Miku because, again, it's nice. I'm an artist, so I get to play. I have like hundreds of hours of interviews, and I'm just going to publish them all, and anyone can use them however they want, because I don't have to play the academic game of like, this is my blade of grass, and nobody else gets to be on it the way book publishing can sometimes be. So again, in the spirit of Miku, I'm letting everybody use my stuff. And we started an online listserv of people who are studying Miku. So if anyone wants to join, we're the Miku Academics or Miku Demics or something, right? Like, I don't know. But there's people at Yale, people at a lot of graduate students, a lot of undergrads, a couple of younger faculty. It's definitely something that's becoming of interest to a lot of people because there's so many ways in.
And yeah. Tara told me that she had a plane ticket.
I do.
Right after her talk.
I do. So I have to be out the door at 5:30 to get to my car at 5:45 at Gilman. So if anyone has any other questions or wants to talk to me.
Well, let's thank Tara.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.